contestation to our principal wasn't a principled one. It was one of practicality. You won't overturn or entrench gender perceptions. Parents won't let their children watch such programs. Really? We don't think this is sufficient justification at all in the face of a society which has seen gender roles entrenched so deeply today that children, boys have hesitation about becoming nurses when girls have hesitations about favoring pink instead of blue. Two points of contention. First of all, does our policy benefit children? Secondly, does our policy benefit wider society? First point of contention, does our policy benefit children? Opposition told us that TV shows need to appeal to children, neglecting the vast amounts of analysis coming out in my first speaker about how these TV shows do still appeal to children because they still preserve their storyline and narrative structure. But here we're going to add an additional layer of analysis, which is that TV shows, under this case, appeal to children even more because the status quo is this. When you have a show that characterizes females as, for instance, strong warriors, they're seen as the exception rather than the norm. This is why I, as a female, for instance, might have my doubts before watching that show because it doesn't seem to be something that intuitively coheres with the rest of the population. On our side, with the normalization, when the bulk of TV programs showcase programs that actively undermine gender roles, I'm far more attracted to watch that show in the first place. So yes, we make it appeal to children. But next, they told us that these are problems with the law, for instance, if females aren't getting paid enough. Yes, so we tackle that problem, that this doesn't negate the problem of perception in the status quo. That was not effective about it at all. But finally, they gave the ludicrous claim. They're flipping gender roles. So just because we implement our policy, all girls are going to want to work as soldiers, all guys are going to want to become teachers? No, this is not a binary at all. But let's make it clear. Even if we accept that there's homogeneity on both sides, which is that on our side, it becomes homogenous, active undermining of gender roles, their side is far worse because they're homogenizing what is already deeply entrenched in so many other facets of society out there. Given that when children go to toy stores, they see Barbie dolls colored in pink, specifically for girls, we think the kind of pervasive gender roles that's entrenched elsewhere means that you should favor our side instead. But next, we're going to point out a very interesting contradiction. They told us that your policy won't work, but if it works, it'll be too effective. This is simply silly. We want the next speaker to clarify it. But next, their first speaker told us that societies are really liberal, they are really progressive. This is a direct contradiction to their context of this debate, where they're going to provide so much backlash when we implement our policy. But next, if society is so liberal, then our policy won't invite much backlash at all. It'll simply be seen as a mixed step in gender progression. Finally, they told us that but children can't appreciate these differences. Well, children don't have to explicitly appreciate these differences, they're embedded in the subconscious. Here we're going to further deepen the analysis. You make it easier for children to accept such messages because it's far less receptive to children when you tell them in a classroom setting, for instance, that, you know, boys can pursue other gender roles as well. When you encode it in TV programs, you frame it as something that's an obvious moral intuition. In a children's TV programs, you have simple concepts like good trumps bad things. These are things we don't question. When you get to adult shows, the line becomes murkier. That's why you have some good characters who may sometimes exercise evil. But on our side, when we frame it in children's TV programs, you make it seem like an obvious moral intuition. But they took all those people's analysis about how TV is a uniquely effective way. They told me, my first speaker told you about time. He told you about the reach to many children out there. He told you about how children are most malleable. All of these
you're more likely to become anti. Please listen to
me. Okay, so for the middle group, how exactly are they like? They're not staunchly conservative or actively opposing our policy. They're likely to be pretty passive with our parents, right? So on our side, they're not going to provide a huge amount of backlash. They're going to force them to consider where the state is coming from. More on that in a second. So first of all, for the group of people opposite Sherman to talk about parents who are most conservative and entrenched in traditional gender norms, the comparative is this. In the status quo, where there's only one or very few TV programs to thank you, challenging gender norms, parents can easily dismiss their children as an exception rather than the norm. On our case, when the bulk of TV programs are primarily those which actively undermine gender norms, so thank you, this volume of media content provides a normalization that allows children to reconsider their perception of reality. So even if parents continue telling their children that you as a girl can only wear a pink dress, at least now children have another narrative which they can turn to. And this is good for them because these are the children who potentially have the most limited choices. So what our position told us was that our parents won't let their children watch TV. Parents will cane them. Parents will scold them. Our first response is this. We think most parents are far more sensible than that. They love their children. They're not simply going to turn abusive all of a sudden just because children want to watch something as a TV program.